One day, Jesus is coming. You may be at church. You may be at work. You may be asleep. God grant that you will be ready when he makes his personal appearance. My God, what if his appearance occurs on a Sunday morning? My prophetic word to you this morning is get ready, get ready.
יברכך אדוני וישמרך. יאר אדוני פניו אליך ויחונקה. יישא אדוני פניו אליך וישם לך שלום.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
And good afternoon, everybody. Happy Sunday, happy Resurrection Day, and welcome to the NTEB House Church Sunday service. My name is Pastor Jeff Greider, and we would like to welcome you today. Your King James Bible presents New Testament church age salvation in the clearest possible light, simplified to the point where you would have to work really hard to miss it. So why then does it seem to get so very complicated? Because most men don't believe the Bible as it stands, and they insist on adding their own secret sauce to make it work better. In the end, what you have is a religious mess designed not to save souls, but to increase church attendance. Isaiah 45:22 says, "Look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God, and there is none else." Here is a short list of things that will not save you in this dispensation. You won't get saved by good works. You won't get saved by begging God. You won't get saved by water baptism, memorizing 1 Corinthians 15:1-4, keeping the commandments, repenting of your sins, tithing, attending church, rosary beads, the Virgin Mary, sacraments, the Eucharist, or saying the sinner's prayer. So how does a lost person get saved, and how should saved people be witnessing to lost people? Well, it's easy. Just as easy as opening a door, taking a drink, or looking in the right place. Here's a hint. If you're arguing, yelling, screaming, threatening, or telling them to pray this prayer and you'll be saved, you're doing it wrong. So what's the right way? You're standing on a street corner. It's 100 degrees in the shade, and you have in front of you an open chest of ice-cold bottles of water with a sign that says, "Whosoever will, take one." On this Sunday service, I want to show you how simple it is to get saved and how simply we should be presenting the gospel of the kingdom of God to lost people. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you, God, for waking us up today. We thank you, God, for the food on the table, for the clothes on our back, and for the roof over our head. We thank you for the little things, the big things, and everything in between. And Lord, we pray, I know every time we do a broadcast of any kind, we have lost people listening. And I pray that something would be said and done this morning that would lead a lost soul to you. And for those of us that are saved and we want to take that gospel message out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, Lord, may something be said and done today that would set a saved soul on fire to want to witness for you and to get something done in these last days. And Father God, we'll give you all the honor and the glory. Because you're worth it, and you're worthy of it. You're not just a great God. The Bible says you're a good God. And we just come before you today and lay it all down and say thank you, thank you, thank you, and we commit this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You know, I've been thinking over the past couple of days and weeks about salvation, and I remember how I got saved. There were no Christians that I was aware of. There was no church reaching out to me. I hadn't been watching any television programs or listening to any radio programs. Nobody gave me a gospel track. So how did I get saved? I went downstairs into the basement and I found a dusty old King James Bible. I brought it up to my room and I opened it. I only knew one verse. After 30 years of being a Catholic, I only knew one verse. And I only knew that verse because I watched a lot of football. And that verse, of course, is John 3:16. I opened up the Bible and I read that verse 32 years ago. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that's Jesus Christ, on a cross, that whosoever, well, that's me, believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And in under 60 seconds, I bowed my head and I got on my knees and I said, Lord, save me. What I just read, I believe it and I want it. I receive it. Save me. There was no crying. There was no begging. There was no, you don't have to beg God. If you think you do, like Paul Washer says, that you have to get on your face before God and cry and beg and scream. If you could just show me one verse in the Bible, anywhere in the Bible, anybody begging God for anything, that's not the relationship that God has with people. You don't have to beg. The Bible says, come now and let us reason together. You know what God says? He says, let's talk it out. Why would God be so concerned about taking something as eternally important as salvation and say, let's talk it out? Well, God wrote a book that's filled with words. And what do you do with words? You read them. You speak them. Jesus says, the words that I speak unto you, they are life. The Bible says that that God's word is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. There is power in those words. And today, I want to talk about a message that God has been putting on my heart for quite some time. The simplicity of salvation. And the simplicity of sharing that message with lost people. And you don't need a megaphone. You don't need a bullhorn. You don't need to chase people down the street. You don't need to yell and scream. You don't need to do any of those things. And this morning, we're going to open up our King James Bibles. And I'm going to show you. Now, I didn't say the easiness of salvation. Salvation wasn't easy for God. He had to get on a cross and he had to be whipped and beaten and mocked and humiliated and scourged by his own creation. Can you imagine? Let's just say that you go out and you adopt a dog and you love that dog and that dog loves you. Well, one day you wake up and that dog's mouth is over your throat and he's ripping out your voice box and you're dying in your own bed in a pool of your own blood, looking into the eyes of the dog that you love. Well, that's what God did on the cross to simplify it. His own creation attacked him. His own creation killed him. Now, of course, he didn't stay dead. Jesus says in John chapter 10, no man taketh my life from me. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. But salvation is simple, simple, simple. I got saved in 60 seconds on a King James Bible. Now, was that easy believism? No. That was biblical believism. And today we're going to talk about the simplicity of salvation. Now, look, one reason why you don't hear a lot of messages about the simplicity of salvation is because people have to make it hard and they have to make it complicated, like Calvinism, something that you have to study. You have to study Calvinism harder than you study the Bible. It twists and it turns and it contradicts itself. It's very complex. But the Bible doesn't twist and turn on itself and contradict itself. The Bible is very, very simple. If we're talking about salvation, it is crystal clear. Whosoever will. That's what the Bible says. But what do? We make it complicated. And men make it complicated so that you will be beholden to their complicated system that you don't really understand. But it sounds right, and they have doctor in front of their name, and they have studied Greek and Hebrew, and you haven't. But you know what? God put a Bible in English. He preserved his word in English. And if you've gotten as far as the sixth grade, then you'll have no problem understanding the King James Bible, because it's written at a sixth grade reading comprehension level. Salvation is not hard. It is not complicated. It is simple, simple, simple. And today, we're going to talk about the simplicity of salvation and the biblical way to witness to lost people in the church age. And speaking of church, welcome. You're here.
It's time for us to face the fact that for decades we've ruined our name. Just look around us. It's easy to see that we share the blame. It's on you.
Each of us are hurting, but we have all been called to carry the message to this human race. Our message is love, our anthem is grace. It's time we remembered who we are.
This is the church.
If you want. is like the ship that sails on the sea of time. Storms may come, winds may blow, and rock this ship of mine. But the reason my ship has never sank, and today it's still afloat, my compass is His precious word, and Jesus pilots my boat. I won't sail the stormy seas no more unless Jesus leads the way. I won't ever drift too far from the shore. I can't hear what He has to say. I belong to a fleet that sails today on a glorious one-way trip. We'll land safely on shore to sail no more, for Jesus pilots my ship. My soul pulled in to save this port. My stern was torn all apart. The bow of the vessel was so badly crushed, sands waters flooded my heart. I had drifted so long on life's angry waves, with my cargo in fear and despair. But then I called on His name, and He lifted the blame. Now He pilots my ship everywhere. I won't sail the stormy seas no more unless Jesus leads the way. I won't ever drift too far from the shore. I can't hear what He has to say. I belong to a fleet that sails today on a glorious one-way trip. We'll land safely on shore to sail no more, for Jesus pilots my ship. We'll land safely on shore to sail no more, for Jesus pilots my ship.
Amen, amen. Jesus pilots my ship. In Matthew chapter 14, starting in verse 27. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be Thou, bid me come unto Thee on the water. And He said, Come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me! And immediately Jesus, man, that's good. Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? We went over that about two years ago now that the Lord gave us that little nugget right there in Matthew chapter 14. The last couple of words, the last three words of verse 30 and the first three words of verse 31, you can hang your hat on that. You can hang your eternity on that. Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus. You know how many people that cried out to Jesus, that came to Him for salvation? You know how many of those people that He turned down? None. The Bible says that Jesus is able to save all those who come unto Him through the Father. And the Bible says that God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And the type of repentance that the Bible's talking about is not the repenting of your sin, because the repenting of your sin can't save you. Because if your salvation was based on the repenting of your sin, then the next time that you sinned, you would lose your salvation. And the Apostle Paul says that we are sealed unto the day of salvation. So what is it that we need to repent? If you're lost, If you're listening to this Sunday service today, and you know that you are far from God, that you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you know what the thief on the cross did? He repented. Not of his sins. The list of his sins would have filled two or three scrolls. He repented of his unbelief in Jesus Christ as the Savior. Lord. He called him Lord. You know how he started out that day? Mocking him and spitting on him just like his other friend did. But then as that thief hung on the cross and he watched, he looked, and he saw how Jesus, being reviled, he reviled not again. And it began to dawn on him that maybe this Jesus of Nazareth, maybe he was the promised Savior, the Jewish Messiah. And at the beginning of the crucifixion, both of those malefactors, both of those thieves, spat in his face, called him names, made fun of him, and mocked him. But then, the one thief, the one malefactor, you know what he did? He repented. He repented of his disbelief in Jesus Christ. And he turned to him. He didn't cry. He didn't beg. He didn't scream. He didn't plead. He just simply said, Lord. He called him Lord. When thou comest into thy kingdom, he acknowledged that he was a coming king and with a coming kingdom. And then he simply said, remember me. Now, is there anything easier than that? Is there anything simpler than that? I shared with you a few moments ago that when I got saved, and I don't want to get into my message so soon, but when I got saved, it happened in about 60 seconds. And I had no pressure on me from any human agency of any kind. But I had overwhelming pressure on me from the conviction of the Holy Spirit that if I died in that condition, I was going to wind up in a place called hell. Nobody was preaching me the gospel. I was getting it straight from the tap. I was getting it straight from the Holy Spirit. Now, you might say to me, well, brother, that doesn't sound right to me. The Bible says that people get saved when people preach the gospel. How could you get saved if nobody was preaching the gospel to you? Well, I didn't say that there wasn't anybody preaching the gospel to me. I just said that there was no human beings preaching the gospel to me. But the Bible says about itself that it is quick and powerful. It is alive. And that book was absolutely preaching to me. And I heard that message, John 3:16, and I immediately accepted that invitation, and I got saved. And today I want to talk about the simplicity of salvation and to take that pressure off of your back. A lot of the times, and maybe they do it ignorantly or unwittingly, or maybe they do it intentionally, but I have seen so many people get this heavy burden put on their back that no human can possibly sustain. And I want to take that burden off of your back today. And I want you to see the simplicity of salvation. Anybody can explain this to anybody else in 60 seconds. That's how simple the Bible is. God is really, really putting this on my heart today. And he's been putting it on my heart for quite some time. And just please pray for me today that I would be able to just simply give the message that God has put on my heart. And I think it will be a blessing for you. We're going to go into our prayer and praise time right after this.
had been committed and my sentence carried out, this day on earth would be my last. Of that I had no doubt. But then the crowd called out my name, and my captor set me free. Who was this man who took my blame and gave his life for me?
I am Barabbas. You've heard my name,
and you may be surprised to find that our stories are the same. I was a criminal in chains, but then
I am Barabbas, and I'll never be the same.
I know that I'm not worthy of the grace that I've received. How blessed I was to hear God's call in the hour I first believed. And now I can identify with the one who'd been set free. If he came my way, if he spoke today, this is what he'd say to me.
Heavenly Father, we thank you and we come before you this morning with our prayers and our praise and our petitions, with thanksgiving, Father God. We're so glad today, Lord, that we can come before you and pray and know that you hear us. Your word says in Philippians chapter 4, rejoice in the Lord alway. And again, I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. You want to know how to pray? You know, the disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray. And he said, after this manner, pray ye, our Father who art in heaven. And he was giving his Jewish disciples a Jewish prayer for a Jewish kingdom. But you and I who are part of the church, we are neither Jew nor Gentile. We're neither bond nor free. We're neither male nor female. And we are all one in Jesus Christ. And you want to know the secret to prayer? It's Philippians 4:6. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. That's how we are to pray in the church age. And so this morning we pray for salvation, for Sarah and Eric and Becky Jacobs, for Greg and Melissa Price, for Shayla Clark's husband, Glenn, Jeanette's granddaughters, Cheyenne, Bridget, Tony, and her boyfriend, Dion, nephew, Matthew, and Jeanette's son-in-law's nephew, Samuel, as well as caregivers, Trista and Tara. We pray for Trevor, Derek, Adam, and Roland Carrier and their families. That's Lorianne's family up in Maine. We pray for John, Jimmy, and David. That's my three brothers up in New Jersey. And we pray for Jesse and his mom for salvation, for healing. Annetta had a stroke almost exactly a year ago. And she trusted the Lord Jesus Christ to get her through. And now she's praying that she'll be able to walk again on her own. So please pray for Annetta for a complete healing after a stroke. Robert Wiley battling ALS disease, and we're praying for him and his wife, Lisa. Linda Watley, she's saved, but she struggles with chronic body pain. Please pray that the Lord would give her strength and comfort. Rob Beattie has stage 4 colon cancer, and but he's hanging in there, and he's actually doing pretty good. And we are keeping him on the list. Clayton Perry, he's going through the side effects of chemotherapy and a cancer battle as well. Aaron Riddle's sister Tracy has metastatic liver cancer. Shira Shine has a growth on her lungs. She's trusting the Lord with that. And she says, please pray for my children, Nicole, Sherry, and Scott. Maddie Luck has been diagnosed with Lewy body dementia, and we are praying for her. Jill Puckett, she says that she needs prayer because she's losing her vision. Rebecca Lynn, her friend Joel Smith, needs to get saved. Linda, praying for Hannah's mom, who is very sick after getting blood clots, praying for healing and for her salvation. Natalie and her husband Ken both need prayers for health issues. Patricia Alliston, please pray for my husband Ron, who has cancer. Sharon Hansen needs prayer for a healing from dementia. Gary says, my friend Carrick from Pennsylvania was recently diagnosed with MS. Jeanette, my mom has another lump in her breast. Please pray. Dina Kruger says, you've been praying for Katrina, who has breast cancer. Now she has severe headaches from lesions in her brain. Please pray for Katrina. Patty Rogalski, her and her husband, Jerry, both have health issues. Patty's going to have hip replacement surgery. Please pray for her. Gail Comfort, who works at the bookstore, she is going to have hip replacement surgery. Ethan, he's part of the husband and wife team that do such a great job keeping our studio and bookstores spotlessly clean. Please pray for Ethan. He has to have hip replacement surgery. Mike Hensel is having knee replacement surgery. Cindy Kettlecamp says that our prayers for Brooke have resulted in a marked improvement in her condition. She got saved. Please keep praying, and we'll be happy to do that. Angel says my mom, Rosemary, was saved, but now her health has deteriorated, and she is in hospice. Please pray for her soon homegoing. My friend Krista, she just told me last week, shockingly revealed to me, I hadn't heard from her in a while, and she has a tumor in her chest that is wrapped around five of her ribs. So please pray for my friend Krista Ray. Dan Keen says, please pray for my wife Roxy with MS and for son Jonathan. Patrick says, please pray for my son Daniel. He's having chest pains after taking the vaccine. Lori P., LS poet in the chat room, is asking prayers for healing from an ongoing infection that she's had. And every time that I lift up that prayer request, it makes me think of the ongoing infection that I have with this nagging, persistent cough. Please pray for me as well. Sharon DeGanius, they are moving her to rehab, and she is talking a lot more. She still has a long way to go, but she is making improvement. So please continue to pray for Sharon, and but that's a good praise report. Jennifer from Idaho needs a healing from chronic neck and back pain that can be debilitating at times. Carolyn from Minnesota is asking prayers for healing for her mom, Joy Piper, in the chat room. She really hurt her back this week and is in much discomfort and pain. I was talking with my friend Rick this morning. He's down in South Florida, and him and his wife are getting ready to come up and to visit the studio that they helped to bring about. And I haven't seen Rick and his wife in 3 years. I very much look forward to spending some more fellowship time with him and her. But in the meantime, he has a bad cold and a fever. Please pray for healing and recovering for Rick. Jill Hall says, please pray for my nephew's two little ones who have been diagnosed with autoimmune diseases this month, that knowledgeable doctors would treat them. Amen. Ladies who are pregnant, Trisha's daughter, Elena Blackburn, my daughter, Kelsey Emerson, Erin Riddle, Gary Tatterson's daughter, Kayla. She's expecting twins in just a couple of weeks. Linda and Joe LaPiana's son and daughter-in-law, they are expecting. April's niece, Shelby, she is due September 4th. She's been having some issues, but so far, so good. Terry Bryant's daughter, Jillian, we're praying for her. And Heather's daughter is pregnant and unsaved, so please pray for her daughter to get saved, and that God would have his hands on all of these ladies, all of these moms, all of the dads, and all of the babies, and that he would just touch and anoint every birthing situation. Mark Saxa, please pray for my son Joseph to return to the Lord. And my son Calvin as well. Please pray for him. Aunt Nancy, please continue to pray for Brandon and Michelle for salvation. Leslie, she has an urgent financial need that is so large. I'm really looking forward to the praise report for this one. But please pray for Leslie and her financial situation. I would love to see the Lord order and reorder that whole thing and set that thing right. The Lord knows what it is. Palmetto State Guy, he's glad and grateful that we have his mom Eunice and his dad Paul on the prayer list for health issues. And I'm glad and grateful for the prayer list as well. Diane, please pray for my grandchildren, 17-year-old Connor and 14-year-old Victoria. You know, Adolf Hitler, long before he became the dictator of Nazi Germany, he started something called the Hitler Youth. Every movement of the devil goes after the children. And Diane's grandchildren are being sucked into the transgender movement. And I have pity and compassion for the victims. I have no pity and compassion for the movement. And I can't wait for the day that God will destroy it. And again, not talking about the people. We are happy to pray for Connor and Victoria and anybody else who has been deceived by this lie of the devil. But the movement itself, we hate the movement. Rebecca D., please pray for my daughter Tamaya, Leah, and pray for me. Ramona Hayes, her daughter Kimberly, she's fighting the demon of alcohol, also has unsaved grandchildren, William Potter, Jason Taylor, David Taylor, Amanda Odell, and their families. Joni is praying salvation for Ashley, Clint, Ember, Knox, Lucas, Brian, Mary, and Dee. Kevin Thompson, please pray for my dad, Tim Thompson, to get saved. Daphne needs prayer for a close friend's daughter and grandbaby that was born 26 weeks premature. Well, at 26 weeks, that would be 14 weeks premature. Rachel, please pray for her friend Jennifer. And she's getting ready to have a lunch, and she wants to witness to her friend Jennifer. And Rachel, I really hope you're listening to today's program, because your prayer request is one of the things that God has used to put today's message on my heart. Sadie, please pray for Sadie to be able to come to the camp meeting. I have had a number of conversations with Sadie over the last year, ever since we started I don't know what you would call it. It's not a program, but about 2 years ago, we made it possible. If people really needed to talk with me, you can go to the website under the About section and you can book a 15-minute time. And I'm very, very happy to talk with anybody for any reason about anything. And Sadie has called a number of times, and she is really looking for a fresh start in St. Augustine, and she's praying that God will answer her. She has a fairly important unspoken prayer request, but she is going to be at the camp meeting. And just please pray for Sadie regarding a possible new life here in St. Augustine. Jill Hall, she's asking prayer for Carly to get saved. She's a young lady, a mother of three boys, who is getting off drugs. She said, I gave her a Bible, told her to begin reading, and that Jesus loves her. Amen, 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 and amen. You know, on a personal level, it excites me when I see people trying to get off of drugs and trying to get off of alcohol and trying to stop smoking and vaping and all the other things that can just destroy your body from the inside out. You know, there's a lot of places that would make you feel shame and guilt about struggling with those things. And I'm certainly not encouraging those things. But let me tell you something. If you're struggling, that means you haven't given up. And that means that you're still in the fight. And I'll tell you something. I struggled long and hard with the things that I struggled with. And well into the ministry over the last 14 years. And that struggle, believe me when I tell you, everybody is in the struggle. Not just everybody talks about it. But we talk about that here. And do you know why? From time to time, you know, people will say to me, you know, you're really open when you talk about your personal failings and the times that you've backslid. Why are you so willing to talk about that? Well, because if God can use that to help free somebody else, I honestly don't care how it makes me look. I really don't. I really don't, because there is nothing more important than breaking those chains. And if you're saved, the Bible says that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil. You have the power to do it. and you got to do it. And I will always, always, always be an encourager of anybody who is struggling and trying to break free. You have a friend here at Now the End Begins. Unspoken prayer requests. The La Piana family, they're sitting right here in the studio today. Jeanette, Marie C., Adrian P. Breda, Chris Hart has a time-sensitive unspoken prayer. Kate, John Bayor, Steve, nope, actually, that's a praise report. God answered his unspoken prayer request in a wonderful way, so I'm taking him off the list. Haley and Dan have an unspoken prayer. Dr. Shirley has an unspoken prayer. Lori has an unspoken. I have an unspoken. And Jericho has an unspoken prayer request. So we're going to just leave those right where they are. Raylene and Sam, well, Raylene Prothero and Sam Givens, they both have birthdays today. We're going to wish them a happy birthday. Eminem says, praise report. Tim Kelly, he had his tracheostomy tube removed and everything went great. And he says, thank you, thank you, thank you to his NTEB family for all the prayers. Jesus Save says, please pray for Colby. Rob says, my best friend Mike, also from Pennsylvania, has MS and is not doing good. He is struggling and unable to find good medical care. He has lost hope and only waiting for God to intervene. Please put on the permanent prayer list. And absolutely, brother, you tell Mike that there's no guarantees what God will do. I know that the charismatics say that it is your right and it's your destiny to always have good health, and that's not true. That's a lie. And saved people get sick just like anybody else. But this is why we pray, and we put it up to the Lord and say, Lord, you do something with this situation, and whatever you want to do, that's fine with us. And we have seen... Well, we have seen some people that we prayed for, God decided to take them home. We have seen some people that we've prayed for, like this woman named Jill up in New Jersey, and she was really under a lot of stress and strain. The doctor told her that she needed open-heart surgery to replace a heart valve, and we put her on the list, and we prayed and prayed and prayed, and then her boyfriend Dave... he contacted me about a month or two later and said she went in for her tests, and the doctor said that she passed her test with flying colors. No need to replace the heart valve. Now, that's what happens when you put it in God's hands. Maybe God will take you home. Maybe God will give you grace and comfort to go through the struggle as a testimony. And maybe he'll give you a healing. We don't know what God will do, but I know this. The Bible says, shall not the judge of all the earth do right? You can put anything in God's hands and say, Lord, you work it out and I'll be happy with the results. And that's how we pray around here. So I said all that to say this. We're very happy to pray for Mike with MS. And Rob says he has lost hope. You tell Mike not to lose hope, and you tell him that his friends at Now the End Begins across America and around the world are praying for him. Tell him about the blessed hope. Jeanette says, Christy, my caregiver, needs prayer for finding an apartment in Texas. It's very, very important. And I haven't heard from Blaine lately. Blaine, if you're out there... reach out and let us know how it's going with you being on the list for the government housing. Jill says, please pray for Rhonda to believe on the Lord. She has a King James Bible that I gave her, and she hears me talk about Jesus. Yesterday, I gave her two bags of cans for a little cash for her. She is not used to receiving something for nothing. She's a recovering alcoholic. And please give her my testimony. And, you know, one of these days, I think I'm going to do a YouTube video where I'm just going to put my testimony out there in video form to make it easier to share. But you can go to the website and grab the link and print it out and give it to her. Andrew, please pray for my friends Season and Alan burying their 25-year-old son Benjamin today for peace and for comfort. And we will absolutely pray for you and for that. Lola, she says, it's kind of silly, but I need a prayer to catch a kitten at my office. I've had no luck. She needs to be spayed. And there are no silly prayers. We pray for people's animals all the time. Jericho Daly, my three brothers, Dennis, Rob, and Rick, they need to get saved. Buddy says, please pray for my cough, meaning me. And I appreciate that, Buddy. Thank you. It's actually not so bad right now. Shannon says, please pray for Jeff and his health, also for the NTEB ministries, and giving thanks for all the blessings through the ministries that we will see when we get home to heaven. Amen. I'm looking forward to that. Sean V, he got saved here a couple of months ago, and now he's asking salvation prayer for the Virno family. Joseph, Sharon, Brigitte, Roxanne, Brent, Callum, Zachary, Xander, and for myself, continued sobriety. Amen, brother. Look, you got to change people, places, and things. You got to stop listening to secular music. You got to stop watching a whole lot of secular movies. You really, really got to level the playing field. But it can be done, and I'm doing it. And the Lord is doing it through me. So we're very, very happy to pray for these family members of the Virno family. And we will absolutely continue to pray for you for continued sobriety. Kenny B. says, Alexia needs to be saved. Lee, please pray for all brothers and sisters in the NTEB church family. Blaine reached out, waiting. But it will happen in his perfect timing. Amen, brother. Annabelle, please pray for my wife, Vilma, for recovering for surgery. Thank you for all of your prayers. Heavenly Father, what a list. What a full plate of prayer requests and praise reports. And Lord, we just come before you and we lay all of this at your feet. I don't know what it's like to have MS. I don't know what it's like to be diagnosed with cancer, but I have seen it in my loved ones and I've seen it in my close friends. And I've held the hands of people at the bedside in the hospice center. And I held my own dad in my arms as he took his last breath. So I have a little bit of an understanding about that, Lord, but only you, Father God, only you know the pain and the fear and everything that's associated with what people go through. And Father God, we just put everything in your hands and we dump it at your feet. And we say, God, answer all of these prayers for your glory, for our good, that you would get something from it, that they would get something from it, that we would get something from it. And Lord, we don't deserve it. The only thing we deserve is death and hell. But you made a way out so that we could get saved and we wouldn't have to go to a place called hell. And Lord, those of us that are sick and those of us that are hurting and those of us that need reconciliation and restoration, Blaine needs a home. Leslie needs a miracle. Sick people need to get well. Lord, you are the great physician and you are the advocate. You are the healer. You are the Jehovah Jireh. And you will provide, Father God. And we don't have to tell you how to do it. You just do it for your glory, and do it for our good, and we'll be happy with that, Father God. And we pray for every lost soul on this list, and we pray for the lost souls that are listening right now silently. They're not in the chat room. They're not reaching out. They're not sending an email, but they're hearing program after program, and they know that they're lost, and they know that they need the Savior. And we pray, Father God, that one of them today, and if not today, then one day soon, would come to saving faith in you. And we just thank you, God. We praise you. And we just dump it all in your lap, God, and say that you are the great God. You are the healer. And just work and move as only you can, Lord. Show us your power. Not because we don't believe, not because we need to be convinced, but because we do believe, and we know your power, and we love to see you work. And Father God, in your name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. I do love our prayer time. It means everything to me. And I believe that that's one reason why God is doing what he's doing with this ministry, because we have never stopped praying. We have never stopped seeking his face. We have never stopped reaching out to him and to let him lead and to let him guide. And whatever results that he gives, I didn't know about a free Bible program. I didn't know about Bibles behind bars. I wasn't planning to open a bookstore. I had no desire to start a podcast. But then everybody started saying, hey, you got to start a podcast. And what a blessing that that has been. I had no desire to start a Sunday service. But then everybody started saying, we need a Sunday service. And look at how many people have gotten saved over the last 3 years just in the Sunday service alone. And so we don't want to tell God how to answer our prayers. And when you really understand that book and you get a little bit of a taste of how God really works and really operates, then you are content to say, be it done according to your will, Father God, and I'll be thrilled with those results. That's how a Bible believer prays. And God is more than happy to answer those prayers. All right, we got to wish Raylene Prothero and Samuel Givens a very, very happy birthday. And we're going to play one song after that. And then we're going to get into today's message, the simplicity of salvation. We'll be right back after this.
You were born. It's the day your mama brought you home. It's a special day. Let us celebrate. Yeah.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. I'm going to celebrate with you. Have you celebrate. Tell everybody. Come on, y'all. Come on, let's celebrate. On your birthday. Come on, y'all. Hey.
And many more.
And many, 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 many more.
There's got to be more.
What will it be?
I'll
Amen, amen. Jerusalem, city of God, it's the city of the great King and Jesus Christ. You know what that book is about? Jesus says this. Well, this verse is about him. Lo, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me. That book from cover to cover is the story, the account, the history, the prophecy regarding the coming king and the coming kingdom. That is the main theme of that book that you hold in your hand. Turn to Isaiah chapter 45. Isaiah chapter 45. And as you're turning there, I just want to give you a quick little update on. We have been talking about having a warehouse for our Bible program because the program has expanded so much that we really, really need to control the shipping now. And yes, we do shipping, but the bulk of the Bibles that we get from Shelbyville, Tennessee, they are shipped out from Shelbyville, Tennessee. And, you know, that's not something that they do there. When they ship out Bibles, they put them on a boat and they send them out to a foreign country. They are not really set up to do the type of shipping that we need them to do. So we have been praying about a warehouse location. And Lori and I were driving in the car yesterday in Palatka, out by where she lives. And we came across what to me looks like an excellent location for the Bible warehouse, for a shipping center. It has everything that you would need all built right into it. I'm just waiting for the for the landlord of that building to get back to me. I have no idea how much the rent is going to be or anything like that. But if you guys would just simply start to pray about that location, and if it's not that location, what the location might possibly be. Because this Bible program, this amazing free Bible program, this Bibles Behind Bars program that God has raised up, the more I pray about it, the more I see that we need that warehouse. So I'm not going to get ahead of the Lord. I don't want to get behind the Lord. So pray about this location that we saw in Palatka yesterday, and just pray whatever God's will might be. He made it very, very clear when he wanted us to open up the studio. He made it very, very clear when he wanted us to open up the bookstore. And I'm assuming that he will also make it very, very clear when it comes to the warehouse for the Bible shipping center. So if you guys would just pray about that, and if you want more information on our Bibles Behind Bars program, you can go there to BiblesBehindBars.com, and you can get all the information that you need. Also, as long as I'm giving updates and announcements, the camp meeting is only 12 days away. Can you believe it? The camp meeting is only 12 days away, and it is absolutely far and away. It's going to be the biggest camp meeting that we've ever had, and just under 200 people are scheduled to be there, and we're very excited about that. But would you please pray, whether you're coming or you can't come, please pray traveling mercies for everybody who's coming to the camp meeting. There's going to be people driving, people flying, people taking trains and buses. So please pray for everybody coming to the camp meeting, people coming from all over the country. And we're very, very excited about that. Regina says that there is a issue in Uganda. If somebody would send that to me through Facebook, I cannot scroll right now through the chat room, but if somebody can copy and paste that and send it to me through Facebook, I'll be happy to mention it at the end of the program today. All right. So if you're just tuning in, today's message, I'm going to talk about the simplicity of salvation. And, you know, one of the really good things about social media and the website that we have and all of the media outreaches that we have, one of the really good things about that is I can post an article about a broadcast that we're going to do. Like yesterday, I posted the article about today's Sunday service. And immediately I began to get feedback, and dozens and dozens and dozens of people have already gone to the website to give their opinion about today's message. And some people, they tuned in to what I was talking about. Other people got a little confused. Some people think that I'm preaching an easy believism. I am certainly not. But suffice to say that salvation is simple. And we live in the church age, okay? We live in the church age. God has made it unbelievably easy to get saved. If you were living back in the time of Moses, can you imagine how complicated it was to try and follow the law? And every time that you committed a sin, you had to go to the temple and you had to have that sacrifice sacrificed for you, and all these things that you had to do. And when you look in the book of Leviticus, and there's certain types of foods that you can't eat, certain types of clothing that you can't wear, things you had to do if you had leprosy, things you had to do if you were a woman and you had your monthly period, and all the different things that the law commanded you to do, and you had to do it. 613 laws for the Jewish people. Aren't you glad that you live in the church age? And aren't you glad that you live in a dispensation where God has made it simple to get saved? So open up Isaiah 45, and then with your other hand, give me Acts chapter 8. So we're going to take a quick look. Let's set the table here. Acts chapter 8 and Isaiah chapter 45. Now, Charles Spurgeon, and I understand he was a nominal Calvinist, and even though that he attended a Baptist church for most of his entire life, but we are not really going to worry about Charles Spurgeon's so-called Calvinism. That's a subject for another day. But there was a day when Charles Spurgeon was not saved, where he knew that he was in danger of hellfire. And he struggled with that. He struggled with that. And Charles Spurgeon, he was walking through the streets one day, and it was snowing and he was freezing cold, and he came across a church that had an itinerant preacher. The main pastor was not there, and he ducked into this church to get out of the cold, and he sat in the back, and he was not impressed with what he heard from the pulpit. The evangelist wasn't very knowledgeable, so he thought. He wasn't very enjoyable to listen to. He just kind of droned on and on. But then there came a moment in this sermon where the evangelist quoted Isaiah chapter 45, verse 22. Isaiah 45, 22 says, "Look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else." Now, here you have Charles Spurgeon in England getting saved as a teenager in the age of grace, in the church age. And what passage did God bless to Charles Spurgeon? Something from the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah 45, 22, "Look unto me and be ye saved." You know what Charles Spurgeon thought as he sat there on that snowy afternoon? Pondering his salvation, pondering his eternal destiny, and fearing the flames of hell. He thought about that verse, "Look unto me and be ye saved." And you know what Charles Spurgeon thought to himself? Well, that's not hard to do. I can look. And as the preacher began to go deeper into his message, and Charles Spurgeon realized he was coming about it all wrong, that he was making it too hard. He was making it too complicated. Isaiah 45:22 says, "Look unto me and be ye saved." Is it hard to look? No. It's the easiest thing in the world to do. I was talking at the beginning of this broadcast about the two thieves, the two malefactors that were crucified on either side of Jesus Christ. They both started out slandering him and mocking him and spitting on him and making fun of him. And then one of those malefactors began to look long and hard in the face of Jesus Christ. And he said, "Lord, when thou comest into thy kingdom, remember me." And Jesus says, "I promise you that this day thou shalt be with me in paradise." That thief on the cross got saved in under 60 seconds, just like I did with a King James Bible on my knees in my bedroom 32 years ago. What did I do? I opened up a book and I looked and I read and I believed what I read and I got saved. Is there anything more simple than that? No. Is that biblical? It absolutely is. That's how the thief on the cross got saved. That's how Charles Spurgeon got saved. Look in Acts chapter 8 as we continue to set the table for my message today. Simple, simple, simple message. Acts chapter 8. And let's start reading in verse 26. "And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise, and go toward the south, unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem for to worship, was returning, and sitting in his chariot, read Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, Go near and join thyself to this chariot. And Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah and said, Understandest what thou readest?" What was that man doing? He was looking. He was looking. Looking at what? The book of Isaiah. And Philip said, "Understand what thou readest? And if you have a paper Bible, why don't you underline verse 31 and next to it in the margin, just put Bible study?" Because this is the very first church age Bible study that ever took place. Acts 8:31. And he said, "How can I, except some man should guide me?" And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. The place of the scripture which he read was this. 1 Corinthians 15:1-4. No. The place of the scripture which he read was this. Romans 3:26. No. How about the place of the scripture which he read was this. Romans 10:9-13. No, no, no. The place of the scripture which he read was this. Isaiah 53. He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so opened he not his mouth. Here's another guy getting saved in the church age on Old Testament passages. Verse 33 says, "In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away, and who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth." And the eunuch answered Philip and said, "I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this, of himself or of some other man?" Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Romans to Philemon. Nope. You see where I'm going with this? Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. Now, how is it possible? How is it possible that you have somebody in the church age dispensation getting saved on Old Testament prophecy? It's possible because of Psalm 40, verse 7. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book it is written of me. You know who the volume of the book is written about? It's written about Jesus Christ. And do you know what happened when the church age started? It ushered in the age of grace that would be revealed by the Apostle Paul. But the Apostle Paul did not usher in the age of grace. The Bible says that the law came by Moses, but grace and truth by Jesus Christ. And when the dispensation of the church age started in Acts chapter 8, Paul wasn't even a disciple. He was still taking Christians and hauling them off to jail. And so the first thing that I want to talk to you about today is that you do not need exclusively the writings of the Apostle Paul to lead somebody to Jesus Christ. Now, I understand that all over the country today, people are sputtering and hemming and hawing. If you were taking a sip of your coffee, and if you're an independent fundamental Baptist, you probably just spat the coffee out of your mouth with what I just said. But it's true. Charles Spurgeon got saved on Isaiah 45. The Ethiopian eunuch, the first Gentile saved in the church age, got saved on Isaiah chapter 53. So the first thing that you have to understand, if you want to share the gospel with somebody, we live in the age of grace. A lost person can get saved on any verse of the Bible from Genesis 1 to Revelation chapter 22. From time to time, people will write to me and they'll tell me that I am not really saved because I got saved on John 3:16 and Paul didn't write John 3:16. Who was it that told you that only the writings of the Apostle Paul can lead you to salvation? Do you have such a low estimation of the Bible to believe that only Romans to Philemon can save your soul? This is one reason why perhaps you struggle when you witnessed with two lost people, because you don't have a high enough understanding of the power of the scripture. That book can talk all by itself. And we live in the age of grace. And what does that mean? That means that God has torn down the wall of separation. When Jesus went to the cross, that veil was ripped in two. And the sacrifice that Jesus gave on that cross made it possible for us to have fellowship with the Father. And when that happened, the scripture was turned loose. And we live in the age of grace. And all you have to do is believe that book. And all you have to do is give that book out to lost people, and you let that scripture do the work. So the first thing that I want to show you today is, if you're lost, you're looking in the wrong place. Isaiah 45:22 says, look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. Turn to Numbers 21:8. And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent and set it upon a pole. And it shall come to pass that every one that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. Now, you might say to me, well, that's Old Testament, brother. Really? Turn to John chapter 3. Turn to John chapter 3. You think that's Old Testament? I got news for you. Look at John chapter 3, verse 14. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, Numbers 21:8, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. You know what they did in the Old Testament? If you wanted to live, God told Moses to put a brazen serpent upon a pole and lift it up and look upon that serpent, and God will heal you. What is that a type picture of? That's a type picture of Jesus on the cross. Why did God use a serpent? Because the Bible says that he who knew no sin became sin for us. He became a curse for us. The Bible says, cursed is everybody that hangeth upon a tree. And that serpent was a picture of Jesus Christ covered with your sin and my sin. And that serpent was lifted up as a sacrifice on the pole. And John 3:14 confirms that. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And then there's that verse, the most often repeated Bible verse in human history, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And that is absolutely and permanently connected to Numbers 21, verse 8. How about John chapter 1, verse 36? And looking upon Jesus as he walked, he saith, behold, the Lamb of God. If you're lost today, it's not complicated. It's not hard to get saved. It's simple. The Bible says, and looking upon Jesus, he said, behold, the Lamb of God. Can you look? Can you look? Even if you were blind, even if you physically had no sight, you can still hear these words and you can get saved. Because you can look to God in your blindness and God can still save you. You don't need human sight. It's not only about human sight. It's about the sight of your heart. The Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So what is your heart set upon today? What are you looking upon today? How about this, Titus 2:13? Looking for that blessed hope. And are you looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ? You know what the Apostle Paul says? And he says this to saved people. But the Apostle Paul says in 2 Timothy 4, verse 8, henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. The people who love his appearing are the people who are looking for him to come back. Are you looking in the right place today? If you're lost, you need to set your eyes upon Jesus. That's where you need to be looking today. And it's not hard. It's not complicated. So am I telling you that getting saved is as simply as easy as looking in the right place? Well, if the Bible is right, that's 100% correct. Look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God. Now you might say, well, that's God the Father. That's written to Jewish people. That's Old Testament. You know what the Bible says about Jesus Christ? The Bible says that he is the manifest image of God the Father. And this is what makes people so crazy when you talk like this, when you say that Jesus Christ is God in human flesh. I don't mean just the Spirit of God indwelling Jesus Christ. I mean that Jesus Christ is the day that God took on a human form. Now, if you believe the Bible, then you agree with me. If you don't believe the Bible, once again, you're spitting your coffee out. Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 through 15. Who has delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have the redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God. What is Jesus Christ? Well, 1 Timothy 3:16, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. So, if you're lost today, let me make it really simple for you. Look in the right place. Look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. That's all you have to do. You have to look. Well, maybe looking is too complicated. Let's try something else, shall we? Turn to John chapter 10. Turn to John chapter 10. Maybe this happened to you recently. Maybe you went out to a restaurant, maybe Chick-fil-A, McDonald's, wherever you like to go to eat. Maybe you were getting in your car to go out for barbecue. And you got to the restaurant and you walked up to the front door and you were just simply paralyzed with fear and didn't know what to do. You looked down at the handle and beads of sweat began to break out in your forehead. Your body began to tremble. If only you knew what to do. No, I can promise you that that has never happened to anybody listening to the sound of my voice. John chapter 10, verses 7 through 9. Then said Jesus unto them again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. You want Jesus? You got to walk through the door. What do you need to walk through the door? You just have to push on the handle and open it up, and you just have to walk through. You just have to look at the right door. And all you have to do is walk through it. You don't have to be qualified. You don't have to have any other thing other than you want what's on the other side of that door. Who is the door? Jesus Christ. You know what Jesus says in Revelation 3:20? Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. You want to sup with Jesus Christ? Open the door. How hard is it to open the door? Well, let me ask you a question. Have you left your house recently? Have you gone into somebody else's house recently? Have you been to any public place of business? Have you been to any restaurant? Did you use the restroom at the gas station? You have to go through two doors to do that. Do you struggle in any area of your life to use a door? You don't. Why is it so much more complicated when it comes to salvation? When Jesus says, hey, you want to know where the door is? I'm the door. Everybody argues about who has the keys to the kingdom. Well, what do you need the keys to the kingdom for when you have the door that is opening itself unto you of its own accord? Jesus said unto them, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. That's all you have to do. The door is wide open. All you have to do is just push lightly on that door, and that door will open itself unto you, and you'll be looking face to face with Jesus Christ, high and lifted up. You know what the Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 2:12? 2 Corinthians 2:12, Paul says this, furthermore, when I came to Troas to preach Christ's gospel, and a door was opened unto me of the Lord. Now, Paul was a saved man, but God uses the illustration of the opening of a door to show you how easy it is to show you how easy it is to walk through that door. All you have to do is be looking in the right place and looking at the right door. Let's take one more example, and I'll be ready to give you my message for today. Maybe you're thirsty today. Here in Florida, it gets hot, it gets crazy hot, and it stays crazy hot, and I love it. I spent 47 years up in New Jersey, in the cold, barren wilderness of New Jersey, and let me tell you something, if you don't think it gets 30 below in New Jersey, you've never been there in the wintertime. It gets very, 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 very cold. Up there. And I love living down here in Florida. I think it's the best weather that I've ever experienced. And I don't mind the humidity. And I just love it. But one of the things that that type of weather causes you to do is you drink a lot. You drink a lot of water. And I want to talk for just a minute about being thirsty. John 4:10, Jesus answered and said unto her, talking to the woman at the well, if thou knewest the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, give thee to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. You know what that living water is? Well, three chapters later in John 7, verses 37 and 38, he explains it. In the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Now, what did those people have to do to get access to that water? All they had to do was come face to face with the living Lord Jesus Christ. All they had to do was look in the right place. All they had to do was knock on the right door. All they had to do was simply take a drink of water. You see how simple God has made the gospel? And we haven't spent 30 seconds talking about the intricate doctrines of Calvinism. We haven't spent 30 seconds talking about the sacraments of the Roman Catholic Church. And are you living in a state of grace? Are you going to die in a state of grace? Did you commit a mortal sin? Did you commit a venial sin? We're not talking about the holiness people who if you don't live a sinless, perfect life, then you'll lose your salvation. You'll die and go to hell. And all this other junk that people pile on top of the simplicity of the scriptures, and they obfuscate it, and they cover it up, and they hide it from people. You don't need Greek. You don't need Hebrew. What you need is the King James Holy Bible and your desire to open it up and to look at the words on a printed page. Now, how hard is it to open up a book and read? Well, let me tell you something. It's a whole lot easier to read John 3:16 than it is to read the instruction manual to one of those couches that you have to put together yourself from IKEA. It's a whole lot easier than that. Am I saying that it's easier to get saved than it is to assemble furniture from IKEA? Absolutely. 100%. That's exactly what I'm saying. When we opened the studio, we have two couches in the front. It took me 8 hours to put those two couches together. One reason why it took so long is the one couch was really big and really heavy. And every time that I tightened one side, the other side loosened up. So I had to play that game for a little while. But the other thing that made it take so long to put those couches together was I could not understand the instructions on that piece of paper. Oh, I could read them all right, but I did not understand what those instructions were saying. But When I got saved on March 14th of 1991, and I read John 3:16 for possibly the very, very first time that I remember reading it. And I read this, "For God so loved the world." I was in need of a loving God at that time in my life. That he gave his only begotten son. I knew that was Jesus Christ. Any lost person knows that that is Jesus Christ. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish. That's what I was looking to do, to not perish. And what I wanted was to have everlasting life. I read one verse that contains exactly 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, and 2 and 5 is 7. I read one verse that had 25 words, and I got saved. Is there anything more simple than that? Did I have to read all the complicated books from the Jehovah's Witnesses, "You can live forever in a paradise on earth"? Did I have to read the Book of Mormon and understand the golden plates and figure out what my relationship to Joseph Smith needed to be? No, I didn't need to understand any of that garbage, any of that junk. All I needed to do was I needed to look in the right place. I needed to come through the right door. And I needed to take the drink that was being offered to me. Now, if you're lost today, you know how to get saved. And the reason why it's hard for you to get saved is because you've got to swallow your pride. Because guess what? Jesus did not come to save the righteous. He said, "They that are whole have no need of a physician." Jesus said that he came to save the lost and the sick and the broken and the hurting and the dying. He didn't come to save rich, happy, successful, wealthy people. He came to save sinners. That's who he came to save. So if you're lost today, let me tell you why it feels hard to you and why you're struggling with it. Because you think that you're not a sinner. You think that, yeah, maybe you have done some bad things, but you're not as bad as a pedophile. You're not as bad as a rapist. You're not as bad as that person who killed those 8 people at the shopping mall in Texas yesterday. You're not that bad. Well, I got a newsflash for you. You're worse than that. And if you don't get saved, you're going to wind up in a place called hell, and there's no door. There's only a one way in, and that door locks behind you. And if you don't get saved today, that's where you're going to be. Now, why would a loving, righteous God send you to hell when you've never murdered somebody? You've never stolen something. You've never committed a crime. Why would a loving God send you to hell? Because you have sin, because you were born in the image of Adam. Genesis 5:3 says, "And Adam conceived a son in his own image and after his own likeness." That's you. You're not God's child. God is under no obligation to save you. God has no covenant with you. But the Bible says, "Shall not the judge of all the earth do right?" And God in his mercy has opened up the floodgates of grace. And you know what you get when you get saved? You get something that you don't deserve. You get mercy. You get salvation. You get placed into the body of Christ. You become a joint heir with Jesus Christ. You get to be a king and priest unto our God. That's what you get, and you don't deserve one single bit of that. But you think you're better than that, and there's where the struggle comes from. And that's why it's hard for you to get saved. But let me make it really simple for you. There's only one sin that can send you to hell. And again, since we're making people mad today, let's make them mad all the way. You don't go to hell because you're a homosexual. You don't go to hell because you're a murderer. You don't go to hell for any other reason other than you have sin in your life that needs to be paid for. God has already made the payment. God went to the cross and he shed his blood. He made your payment. And all you have to do is look in the right place, walk through the right door, and take the drink that is being offered to you. And all you have to do is receive it. You know what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 1? Ephesians chapter 1, and we quote this passage all the time. And if you're lost today, I want to show you how simple it is to get saved. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 12, Paul says that we should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ. If you're lost today, it's because you have not trusted in Christ. You've looked at the wrong things. You've walked through the wrong doors. You've drank the wrong drinks. And you know what I'm talking about. But Paul says in Ephesians 1:12 that we should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ, in whom ye also trusted. Now, when did you trust? Well, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Charles Spurgeon heard it in Isaiah 45:22. The Ethiopian eunuch heard it in Isaiah 53. I heard it in John 3:16. The gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance, the down payment, until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. Now, give me 5 minutes and I'll be done with my message for today. If you're lost today, if you're lost, the only thing stopping you from getting saved is you. The only person making it hard for you to get saved is you and your pride, because you don't believe that you're bad enough to deserve hell. But let me assure you, you absolutely are. But God, in his mercy, has already made the way of escape for you. It's a payment that was made. You know, when Jesus went to the cross, you know whose sin he paid for? Adolf Hitler, Jeffrey Dahmer, John Wayne Gacy, Genghis Khan. He paid for the sin of the whole world. So why is Adolf Hitler not in heaven? Because Adolf Hitler rejected that payment. He didn't want that payment. He was above that payment. If you want to get saved today, look in the right place. Walk through the right door. Drink the right drink. And you'll be saved before you know it. Now, for those of you that are saved, and God has called you to go to the streets and preach the gospel, let me encourage you in what you're doing, and let me encourage you to keep it simple. Let the scripture do the work. All you have to do is to tell them about the payment that God has already made on their account and on their behalf. That's all that you have to do, is simply point them to the Savior. You don't have to yell. You don't have to scream. You don't have to pick up a bullhorn and melt the eardrums of the people who are walking past you. All you have to do is point them to look in the right place. All you have to do is show them where the right door is. And all you have to do is show them where that living water is. And when you do that, I promise you, God will bless the ministry that you're doing, and you will begin to see fruit, and more fruit, and much fruit. Let the scripture do the work. I promise you that you're not smart enough, and I'm not smart enough to be able to convince somebody to get saved. You can't do it. That's why God wrote a Bible. That's why he left a book that anybody can read. Blind people can read it. Deaf people can hear it. Anybody can read that book. There is no person living that cannot be reached, no matter what their condition is, with the life-saving message of salvation. New Testament, church age, rightly divided. Now, if you're saved, you understand that God commissioned the Apostle Paul to lead us, to be our leader. Paul says three times, follow me as I follow Jesus Christ. And that's what we are called to do, to follow the Apostle Paul. But that book is any verse from Genesis to Revelation is capable of saving any lost soul. All you have to do is you just got to preach that book, and you got to point people to the right place. And when you do that, God will bless. And if you're lost today, you're looking in the wrong place. Look at Jesus. If you're lost today, if you're thirsty for something, stop drinking the wrong things and take a drink of that living water. Jesus says, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, that's all you have to do. As the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, and we praise you. And Lord, I just pray for any lost soul that is listening, that the message you put on my heart came through today, Lord. The simplicity of salvation. We just need to look unto you, to walk through the door that you are, and to drink that living water that comes from you, Lord. And that's the gospel. That's the Bible. That's the book. And God, we thank you today for the book, the blood, the blessed hope. And we pray that that this message will bear fruit for you, that a lost soul will get saved, and that a saved soul, Lord, will just give the simplicity of the gospel. Make it clear, make it plain, make it easy for people to understand. We don't need to yell and scream and shout and cry and beg. We just simply need to preach Jesus Christ and him crucified, died, buried, and risen again on the third day for our salvation. And Lord, we just pray all these things and give so much thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for tuning in today and for being part of the NTEB Global Family of Bible Believers across America and around the world. Please pray for the camp meeting, which is taking place in 12 days. Well, actually, no, less than that, because today is the 7th and it starts the 19th. All right, that's 12 days. So please pray for the camp meeting and for everybody traveling. Please pray for the people that will be preaching. That's myself, Pastor Joel Tillis, Pastor Dave Struble, and Dr. Bill Grady. And please pray for everybody that shall be attending. Thank you so much for tuning in, and Lord willing, we'll see you back here tomorrow, noon Eastern time for, there is somebody sent me a message about something. Erad says, regarding the situation in Uganda, it's an unspoken. We were hit by a serious rain, which caused serious flooding, and we lost a number of lives of children. But thank God my community was not hit. Erad is saying that there are some needs that we will be prayerfully considering. And he says that they're looking to raise some money to help those families. And I will pray about that. And we will see what the Lord will lead us to do. But please pray for that flooding situation in Uganda and how the Lord would want us to respond to that. Julie Baird says, please put my grandma, Wilma Baird, on your prayer list. She just got admitted for a stroke. Also, my son's dad wrecked his bike and fractured his skull. His name is Chris Philpott. So please pray for Wilma Baird. She had a stroke. She's in the hospital. And for Julie Baird's son's father, Chris Philpott, who fractured his skull in a bicycle accident. All right. Have a great rest of your day, everybody. And Lord willing, we'll see you back here tomorrow, noon Eastern time, for another Prophecy News podcast. Have a great Sunday, everybody.
My friend, I stand in judgment now, and I feel that you're to blame somehow. On earth, I walked with you day by day, and never did you point the way. You knew the Lord in truth and glory, but never did you tell me that old, old story. My knowledge then was very dim, and you could have led me safely to Him. And though we lived together on earth, you never told me of the second birth. And now I stand this day condemned, because you failed to mention Him. You taught me many things that were true. I called you friend, and I trusted you. But I learn now that it's all too late, and you could have kept me from hell and my fate. We walked by day and talked by night, and yet you showed me not the light. You let me live and love and die, and you knew I would never live on high. I called you my friend in life. I trusted you through joy and strife. And now coming to this horrible end, could I now call you my friend?
You never mentioned him to me. You held me not the light to see. You met me day by day, and you knew I was astray. Yet you never mentioned Jesus, this Jesus to me. Jesus to me. Yet you never mentioned
Jesus, this Jesus to me.